Thank you for tuning in to LA Talk Live, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we're more than just talk. Stay tuned.
Mountain Valley Spring Water.
No, the bed feels warmer, sleeping here alone. You know I dream in color and do the things I want. Think you got the best of me, think you've had the last life, but you think
hello, hello, hello. That was an interesting song to segue into. Anyway, I'm Lucinda Bassett, stress and anxiety guru, and I'm wearing glasses, and many of you have never seen me in glasses, so this is a new experience for all of us. But I am older now, and I do need reading glasses, which is anxiety-producing in itself. Anyway, I'm so excited to be here. That's what I look like without glasses. This is my first show with LA Live, and yay! Woo, 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 woo! And I like it because we opened up with What Doesn't Kill You Makes You Stronger, which has kind of been the story of my life. So whoever picked that, James, did you pick that?
Yes.
Okay, you did a great job.
Thanks, Lucinda.
Anyway, I don't know if you know who I am, but I will share that with you. I am Lucinda Bassett, and I am a self-help guru. I've been on television and radio for about 18 years, specializing in anxiety and depression, panic disorder, stress, you name it. And I've been fortunate to have a very, very good career in those areas, helping people. And that's one of my favorite things to do, actually. And I have three books out. One is called From Panic to Power, which has gotten quite a bit of recognition. And then Life Without Limits, which didn't get very much, which was also stressful and anxiety-producing. And then my latest book, which was out last year, called The Solution. And I have laryngitis today, so bear with me. I know it sounds kind of sexy, so it works for some of you. Some of you might be irritated by it, but that's what's going on with my voice. Anyway, I'm so excited to be here. This is just kind of a turning point for me in my world and my life. Ironically, I've been on radio for a long time. With commercials, you've probably heard me going, are you up late at night struggling with anxiety? You know what it's like. You sit on a plane in panic. You reach for that glass of wine. Maybe you pop a pill, but who knows? Anyway, that's me. So I've been doing radio for many years. I'm also, you might be up at night at 2 o'clock in the morning, unable to sleep because of panic and anxiety. And lo and behold, there I am on your television screen talking about how to overcome panic attacks, how to sleep better, how to overcome depression. We have the longest running infomercial, which is really good news. And so it all led me to here and now and being present and doing this show. My message has changed a little bit in the last 4 years. Some of you may know, those of you who know me, which may not be all of you, but some of you, that I lost my husband 4 years ago. And unfortunately, I had 5 siblings. I lost 4 of them, my mother, my father. But 4 years ago, my husband David committed suicide, which was very traumatic and very challenging for myself and my children. But what it did is it led me to this path of my own recovery and discovery that forced me to create some new skills for myself and my family that created a book. And so out of this horrible, horrific experience came a little bit of a light at the end of a very dark tunnel. And God was once again pushing me on the back and saying, now you get out there and show other people how to get beyond it. So that's what I'm doing. And that's my next mission in life. So I've gone from being kind of an anxiety and depression expert to being a grief and tragedy trauma expert. And really, to be honest with you, this show is going to focus on everything. The show is Truth Be Told with Lucinda Bassett, and it's my goal and my promise to you to bring you the truth about topics, everything from stress and depression to suicide, difficult children, and bad marriages. So today we're starting out and talking about stress and anxiety because that's a topic that's very close to my heart, and obviously something that I've specialized in a long time and certainly had my share of, and especially in the last 4 years. So I hope you'll stay with us and join us and enjoy the show. We have a wonderful in-studio guest today, and then a couple people will be calling in for some good advice and free advice. And so I'm excited to share all of this with you. It's interesting because the other night I was watching television and it said that suicide is the number one cause of death even over cancer right now. And a lot of that is because of the soldiers coming back from the war, but a lot of it is also just the economy. And people are more stressed and anxious and depressed and suicidal than they've been in years. And it's times have been very tough since about 2008, middle of 2007, when the economy started to downswing. And of course, it affected unemployment and it affected the housing industry. It affected people's jobs. It affected people's financial security. And the unfortunate thing about all of that is it rolls into affecting marriages and then how you parent your children and your own personal stress levels. And your, when you are threatened financially or your personal security is threatened, it then makes you stressed and anxious and afraid. And that affects your ability to sleep, your ability to function, your ability to be happy and be pleasant and be good, fun to be around. And people tend to get anxious. And I know a lot about anxiety. I had anxiety disorder when I was 7. Then I had it again at 12. And then it really manifested at 18 in college. And it manifested as panic attacks and obsessive scary thoughts and hyperventilation. And the irony for me that I talk about in my new book is that for a long time in my life, my biggest fear was losing my mind. I used to obsess and obsess about going crazy. And I remember being a little girl, and I talk about this in the book, driving through Toledo, Ohio with my mother in the pouring rain, and there was this ugly old ominous building, and I said, "Mommy, what is that?" And she said, "Oh, well, that's a mental institution." And I'm like, "Well, what do they do in there?" And she said, "Oh, well, they lock people up who are crazy." And I'm looking at the bars, you know, and it's lightning and thundering, which was not helping. And I'm like, "Well, who goes crazy and what does that mean?" And she was like, "Oh, well, you kind of just can't." She starts explaining insanity to me in a very Midwestern, you know, motherly kind of scary way. Because my mother used to have this way of saying, "Well, if you think that way, that's going to happen to you." And I think that was her way of trying to tell me to stop talking about it. It was really effective because I just, "You know, Mom, what if I become possessed by the devil?" "Well, if you think that, that's going to happen." Then I'd go, and then I'd think, "All right." And then for the next 3 days, I'd be obsessed about that, you know. So I became an obsessive thinker. And then I became very obsessed with losing my mind. And if someone would have told me, and I mean, I worried about that until I was in my 40s, really. Even when I was Lucinda Bassett, working with people with anxiety and depression, there was still once in a while I'd think, "But what if I went along and at 50, when my life's just going so well, and went crazy?" And then I finally started realizing, you know, it doesn't happen. People don't go along at 50 and lose their mind. And then lo and behold, my husband, my partner, my lover, my best friend, my children's father did exactly that. And I did decide to share that book or to share that story in a book that will be available March 1st. That's incredible and powerful and real and raw. And I wrote the book because I know a lot of you listening are struggling right now. And maybe you're not suicidal, or maybe you are. Or maybe you know someone who committed suicide, or maybe you've tried yourself, or maybe you've thought about it just because you're so overwhelmed. And so I felt like it was my mission to step forward and offer people hope. And if you guys, if we have to take breaks or anything, we didn't get a chance to talk about that. You just need to let me know. This is my first show, so bear with me. I'm having a little bit of anxiety about I literally was lost getting here, ran in the door and sat down in front of you. So raise your hand or something, or say, "Break!" And we'll figure that out. Break! Does that mean we got to take a break? That means we got to take a break. Okay, we're rolling to a break. We'll talk in a few minutes.
What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes you fighter. Put that fever lighter. Doesn't mean I'm over, 'cause you're gone. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger, stronger. Just me, myself, and I. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
Hi, this is James Kinney from Kinney Group Creative, inviting you to join us every Thursday from 2 p.m. to 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time for our all-new show, What Catches Fire. We're going to be discussing the love, life, and politics of the American brand. So don't forget to tune in to latalklive.com every Thursday from 2 to 3 p.m. exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio, or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, this is Lady J inviting you to join me every Thursday from 4 to 5 p.m. for my all-new show, Lady J's Wild World of Sports. Join me as I highlight all entities associated with sports, from athletes, trainers, referees, and even actors that have portrayed athletes. Okay, so don't forget to tune in to Lady J's Wild World of Sports exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also catch me on iTunes Radio R&B or watch me on Ustream.tv. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk, okay?
Hello, hello. Welcome back to Truth Be Told with Lucinda Bassett. We're here to talk about everything from stress to difficult children. So I promise you one thing, you're going to hear the truth. So if you're looking for some answers and some free advice, please feel free to give us a call. Do we have a call-in number?
323-247-7443.
That would be James Kenny in the background ripping that number out. It's 323-247-7443. And again, you're with Lucinda Bassett on Truth Be Told. You call me and we'll tell you the truth. And we'll talk about just about anything you want to talk about. We have an incredible guest with us today. Hello, Jennifer.
Hello.
Welcome to radio.
Thank you.
Have you ever been on the radio?
No.
Okay. It was your big moment. Shine in that moment. Sparkle. Anyway, thank you so much for coming in to share your story with us.
Thank you.
It's my understanding that you've had some experience with anxiety and panic disorder.
Absolutely.
So rather than me going off about the symptoms, why don't you share your story?
Oh, as far as I can remember back, I've always had anxiety, get the sweaty hands, the tense stomach, racing heart. And I used to medicate with drinks or something in order to go out in public. Then I just kind of started being a hermit, I guess, a little bit.
Yeah, staying away from what
made me anxious.
Right, so you avoided the things that caused the feelings
Absolutely.
Of anxiety. And by the way, since we are on a little bit of a time thing here, I got to get used to that. What made you anxious? Flying, driving, socializing, going into malls? What made you anxious?
Flying. I do not go into banks because I just know it's going to get robbed when I'm in there.
Okay.
And just being
especially
in,
right now.
Right.
It's probably true.
And large social gatherings.
Yeah, so that's when you would drink.
Yes,
just to calm down.
Absolutely.
Okay. When did you realize you had anxiety? That it was not that you weren't did you ever phrase you're going to go crazy like me? Did you what's wrong with me? Am I losing my mind?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, I would look at people and I would be like, okay, they're fine with this. Why am I not?
Yeah, why?
You know, I never understood that.
What do you feel inside when you got really anxious?
Oh.
Take me
like,
there. Like you're standing in a bank.
Oh, I look around constantly.
Yes.
I look for any danger.
Is your heart pounding?
Absolutely.
And are you hyperventilating like that?
Yes.
And were you ever afraid you might have a heart attack or pass out or get sick or embarrass yourself?
I've definitely had panic attacks. And whenever I get anxious, like I always do something that draws attention to myself unwittingly. Like, I will just, you know, say something, do something, and then I'm like, oh, everyone's looking at me.
You think they are. You
yes,
think they're looking
absolutely.
At you. Absolutely. Okay, so what's so interesting to me is, you might, what are you, 22? See?
I wish.
Anyway, see, I just wanted to demonstrate how good it feels to feel good and how easy it is to feel good. Just some little stupid comment about yourself. You know, you don't look anxious. You look happy. You look happy pants. You don't look anxious. I mean, and that's the funny thing about people with anxiety disorder. Most of them, you wouldn't, they're sitting there going, everybody's looking at me. Everybody's staring at me. Everybody knows I'm panicking. Nobody would know because you're sitting there looking like the most cool together chick in the world. And from what you're telling me, you're still having some issues with it. You don't, right?
Absolutely. It has gotten worse in the past couple of years.
Have you done anything to get help?
Oh. I've been to doctors. They want to put me on medications. To fly, I definitely have to take
something.
Something.
Do you take an anti-anxiety medication? We won't name the brand.
Yes.
Because that can be very helpful.
Yes.
Okay? I mean, I will tell you, not that I'm here to support medication, but I think a 0.25 milligram of Xanax that you break in half and take half of if you're a fly or if you got to speak or, you know, you don't need to take it every day, three times
right.
a day. That's the beauty of that medication. In my opinion, that's one of the most effective. If you can get the smallest dose, break it in half. What it does is it just takes the edge off and you don't feel as panicky. And that's okay. But the other thing you need to do is understand that anxiety disorder is genetic. So more than likely you had a mother, father, or someone in your family who was a nervous person or a worrier.
Yes.
Who was it?
My mother.
Yeah, see, your mother, is she still around?
Yes.
Okay, see, my mother, I'd call her about something, you know, she'd say, that worries me. That worries me. That worries me. And I'm like, well, then maybe it should worry me. And I remember saying, you know, Mom, I'm not really worried about anything right now. She goes, well, that worries me.
Oh,
no. I'm really in trouble. But I grew up with a worrier, my mother, you know, and then you find sometimes then you have your worry buddies. You call each other and worry together. What are you worried about? Well, that. I'm worried about this too. You ought to be worried about that. We should be worried about that. Before you know it, your guys got it going on and you're just worrying about everything. So what do you do now? Do you hang out with people who worry? Do you have worry buddies?
My mother.
I hope you're not listening today, Mom. But if you are, Jennifer says she loves you very, very much, and she's worried that you might be listening. But in reality, if you're listening, it's a good thing because you've raised an incredibly beautiful young woman as a daughter. And the thing about worriers that you probably don't know, Jennifer, is that worriers make great, how can I say this? Worriers make great planners, and they make great goal setters because worrying is a skill that is something that, you know, if you're a good worrier, you're very analytical. Do you like to think?
Absolutely.
Okay, you are a perfectionist usually. Okay, tell me if I am wrong on any of this. Okay, you're very creative with a vivid imagination. Oh, yes,
not
you.
Not so much.
Come on, someone's might going to step into this bank and rob me today? I think that's pretty creative. I bet you even get go.
That's realist.
No, it's not. That's a realist. No, that's someone with a very creative imagination running amok. You probably got to figure out what they're going to look like. Anyway, my point is this. Well, you just let me finish. Anyway, so you have a great imagination. You're very, very intellectual. You like to think a lot. You also are a futuristic thinker. So you anticipate, unfortunately, the worst. But my point is, if you could take all those great skills of worrying that you use to make yourself sick with worry that are not realistic and turn them outward where they belong, then you become a fabulous goal setter because now you can use the skill of being introspective and creative to visualize the future about what you want for yourself. So instead of wasting your time worrying and scaring the crap out of yourself about things that aren't even going to happen, let's use that energy of worry, that creativity, that futuristic thinking, that vivid imagination to go out and decide what you want to do with the rest of your life and to make your dreams come true. And I want you to really think about that because especially if your mom's listening, because, you know, I think one of the things about anxiety that I've done differently. And the reason my book From Panic to Power became a bestseller was because instead of saying, gee, you have anxiety that and depression, well, there's something wrong with you. You're dysfunctional and you need to be fixed. No. In fact, if you have anxiety and you're a worrier, you are just chock full of opportunity for potential because you are creative and you are introspective and you are intellectual and you are sensitive and you are a perfectionist and you do think into the future. So imagine what you could do if you could take all that great energy and turn it around and put it outside of yourself and use it to get where you want to be in life. Where do you want to get to be in life?
Oh, I don't know. I always worry about what could go wrong if I try to achieve something.
Can you imagine if you could pick out what I want to give you a homework assignment. Pick four things. Let's just say five things that you'd like to achieve in the next 2 years.
Okay.
And you know, I want you to listen to this. The average person, how much time do you think you spend worrying a week? Hours.
Oh, hours?
Mm-hmm. Throw it out there.
I don't know. Any waking hour?
Do you want me to tell you? Any waking hour. So we're talking maybe like, you know, what, 15 hours a day or?
At least.
Probably. The average person, and we both know that you're not average, spends 20 hours a week worrying.
Wow.
Okay. That's the average person. Now, let's just ask yourself, what could you do with those 20 hours a week if you weren't wasting it with worry? What could you do if you took 20 hours and if you went to the gym 20 hours a week, if you went back to school for 20 hours a week, if you invested in a relationship with some guy 20 hours a week, if you spent more time with your mom,
I'm going to throw you in there, mom,
20 hours a week, which she'd probably love. You know, if you spent 20 hours a week on a spiritual journey or reading books about growth and dreams and spirituality, what do you think would happen in 20 hours a week, a year from now? But instead, you're throwing it away on worry. So I want you to think about that. Your homework assignment is to come up with five goals that you'd like to achieve over the next year. And then what I would do is I would teach you this. I'm going to give you my book. I don't have one with me, but we'll make sure you get one. But before you know, we'll get your address. I have a skill I call worry reversal, where I show you how to take those skills of worry that I talked about, creativity, vivid imagination, futuristic thinking, planning, overanalyzing, and use those to, first of all, determine, you know, what you want. Because if you don't know what you want, how are you going to go after it?
True.
Right?
True.
So, first of all, let's clarify what you want. Let's pick five things you'd like to achieve over the next year. And then let's use those skills to help you get them. And then we use a skill called worry reversal to help you determine, you know, how can I work every day to, instead of worrying about something that's not going to happen, like being robbed in a bank, to thinking, gee, I'd like to go back to school and get an associate's degree. How can I take the steps to make that real for me and use these same thinking skills to make that happen? And then what happens is instead of filling your 20 hours with worry, you're going to fill that 20 hours with productive power thinking and planning to make some of your dreams come true. Do you believe that you can do that?
Yes.
Okay, then that's half the battle. Yay! Jennifer, you're going to have your own show by this time next year. You'll be sitting there going, I remember when I was sitting here with Lucinda Bassett. I wasn't late. I made it in 10 minutes early. Anyway, I'm so glad you came. I hope this helped. I'm going to give you my book. One thing I will tell you is you can overcome panic attacks and they will go away for good. And I'm going to show you how to do that in my book, From Panic to Power.
Perfect.
So thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
And maybe I'll see you around in the bank in the next couple days. Okay, we have to take a little break. Come back with me. Don't panic. I'll see you in a few minutes.
Hi, this is Dr. Levi, your fitness doctor, making a personal house call, inviting you to join me Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific for my all-new show, The Dr. Levi Show. Join us as we discuss fitness, health, and well-being, including emotional and spiritual health. So don't forget to tune in to The Dr. Levi Show every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com and the Talk Live Broadcast Network. You can also catch us on iTunes, Radio R&B, or watch us on Ustream.tv, or catch us on the Live 365 Network, and now on Radio Flag and Stitcher Radio. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
People, it's Jennifer Tapier from StarCam. You guys might know me from the red carpet, catching up with all the stars, but guess what? We're bringing the red carpet to the radio right out here on LA Talk Live. I'm going live Thursday nights at 6 p.m. We got hot topics, celebrities, and much more. We were featured on Chloe Lamar on E!, Howard Stern, T.I.'s Family Hustle. You know how we do. So check it out on Thursday nights, 6 p.m. All things Hollywood, everything celebrity. StarCam Radio?
StarCam Radio?
StarCam Radio!
Oh yeah, follow us on Twitter, at StarCam Radio.
You know the bed feels warmer, sleeping here alone. You know I dream in color, and do the things I want. Think you got the best of me, think you've had the last laugh, bet you think that everything good is gone. Think you left me broken down, think that I'll come running back. Baby, you don't know me cause you're dead wrong. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger, stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes you fighter, put that fever on.
I do like to dance. I'm sorry. I will be dancing on this show. Did they tell you that? This is called Dancing with Lucinda. It's good therapy. Anyway, welcome back. This is Truth Be Told with Lucinda Bassett. That would be moi. And I am going to, you know, share all kinds of wonderful things with you over the next coming weeks. I'm so excited to be here. Where's that applause?
Yay!
Yay! Yay!
Oh, hey, by the way, Lucinda, we do know that your book is now available via pre-order at barnesandnoble.com.
Yes, James. James. This is James Kenny. He's not on camera, but he's a gorgeous guy over here.
Oh, thank you.
You could come over here and then they can see your beautiful face. He's also got a show on this network. He's my marketing guy. How cute is he? Anyway, girls, he's single.
Yeah.
And he has no drama. Well... Maybe just a little bit. Anyway, we're so excited to be bringing you Truth Be Told, and we're going to be talking about all kinds of wonderful things on this show. Anything you want to talk about, if you want to call in, the number is 323-247-7443, and my name is Lucinda, and we actually have a caller joining us now. Linda, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can hear. We got you, girl. Girl, shine your light. You just shine that light. You know, Linda, do you remember that song? I have this thing going on in my little head right now because I've been through a really tough 4 years. I lost my husband, then I had to sell my business, then I lost my brother, then I lost my mother. So, you know, it was a really tough 4 years for me. But what I've started to see happening in the last 6 months is this. I've always had this little light, and it was, you know, shining. I don't know. Do you remember, Linda? I'm probably much older than you, but do you remember that song goes, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine." Remember that? And then it go, "Don't let anyone it out. I'm gonna let it shine." Remember that?
Oh yes. I taught it to a lot of little kids over my time.
Well, see, and I remember sitting in church camp, you know, in Ohio, Sandusky, Ohio, singing that song. And I had no idea of the power of that song. Maybe that should be on some of our shows, that could be the little break song.
Yeah.
This little I do too, because for a while there, my light was put out when my husband died. And I couldn't get it back. And my beautiful children kept saying, "Mom, you're going to, you know, you're going to shine again. Your little light's going to come back. You got a life to live." And I'm like, "No, I can't do it without David. I can't. I can't." And the thing that I'm feeling in the last couple of months, I'll have to share a story with you, but is my light's back, and it's just sparkling. And
that deserves applause.
Yeah. Where's our applause?
Yay.
And thank you very much. And I just think that my goal in the next couple of years is to help people whose lights have gone out, to help them come back again so that they can, you know, number one, illuminate and see the way for themselves and their families, and also so they can sparkle, you know, from their souls.
Yes, and until you experience just that first glimpse of it, you don't think it's ever going to come back.
No, and then there are people who will try to put it out, which is even scarier. Right. And so I want to hear your story. What's your story?
Well, go ahead. We're a little bit breaking up, so I'll do my best to hear you and not interrupt.
Yeah, you know what? You sound fine. You're not breaking up at all. So just go ahead and tell me a little bit about what's going on with you.
Okay. Well, basically, my journey into the descent of mental illness started, you know, early on. I was a very anxious child, came from, like you said, a genetic background of mental illness. And when I was 23, I had my first full-blown panic attack driving a car. And I had no idea what it was I was experiencing. I just thought that I was going to have a heart attack. I was losing my mind. And all I wanted to do was, at the next red light, get out of that car and go screaming down the street
and
hope somebody would help me.
So just for a minute, and Linda, so, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay.
Sure.
Take me to that moment. I mean, there you were, you're 23 years old, you're driving down the road, and all of a sudden, out of the blue, what?
Well, out of the blue, I suddenly felt like I couldn't breathe. I felt like my heart was beating out of my chest. My hands felt numb. You know, it was a long time ago, and I don't remember all the symptoms, but they took place over and over and over again after that.
And so what that sets you up for a fear of it reoccurring. So you had a panic attack, and then it's like, my gosh, what was that? Horrible thing. Was I dying? Am I losing my mind? And then it becomes, what if? That's when the what if thinking starts. What if that happens again? Right? So then what happened to you then?
Well, I got home and I went to bed and managed to get to sleep. And then I woke up with that familiar feeling we get where something's wrong. What is it? And you start going through your list. And then I remembered what happened to me on the way home, which had no label yet at that time. And I thought, oh my gosh. And then the feelings began to happen again. And I thought, oh, it's coming again. And it went right back into another full-blown panic attack right there in bed before I even got out of bed.
Okay, so how many years ago was that?
That was in 1973.
And so now you're what, in your 40s or something?
No, I am 61.
You're 61, girl?
Wow. Yes.
Yeah. Your little light's just glowing, boy. Okay, well, first of all, you're an inspiration to all of us, you know.
Absolutely.
Do you work with people with anxiety and depression, or what is it you're doing now? And how did you overcome it? And are you over it?
Oh, yes, I'm over it. The problem was for me back in 1973, there weren't people like you talking about it. And I went to a regular, what I thought of as a Freudian psychiatrist.
Right.
And we started going back over the whole traumatic childhood and how did I feel about this and that. And I just got worse and worse and worse. And I developed major depression and suicidal ideation. And when you were talking earlier about becoming obsessed with losing your mind, that's where I was at. Nobody said to me, this is anxiety, this is a panic attack, this is what's happening to you. So I just thought I was crazy, and nobody was telling me anything.
Okay,
other
so
than that.
Now, according to my information here, you're now a licensed marriage and family counselor, correct?
Yes, I'm a licensed professional counselor and a marriage and family therapist. And then I'm also certified in dialectical behavior therapy. I don't know if you
I'm not familiar. I'm not familiar with it. Familiar with that. What is that?
Well, that was it's been researched for over 20 years, and it's a treatment that combines cognitive behavioral therapy with straight behavioral therapy and mindfulness, and it works towards those that have that high reactive arousal, quick to go to their feelings, and a slow return to what feels like normal to them. Usually it's genetic, or it can be genetic and then traumatic events bring it on, but it's been researched for about 20 years. So I work with mainly teens right now doing skills groups and then individual therapy, and I also work with adults with panic disorder, agoraphobia, depression,
Well, let me in looking at your bio sheet here, the other thing that's clearly very close to my heart and intriguing to me is that your father and your brother both committed suicide.
Yes, my brother committed suicide about a year and a half after this very first panic attack. And I was spiraling into, serious mental illness at the same time when he was suffering from major depression after returning from the Vietnam War.
My parents
were basically depending upon me to save him.
Right. Okay.
And I couldn't.
Mm-hmm. Of course not.
And so his death, he was a year older than I was and the closest thing to my heart. And so his death very much complicated my recovery. And then my father, 3 years later, followed suit and committed suicide. And I was present at both of those events. So that triggered for me even more serious mental illness, major depression with psychotic features. And that whole time I was suicidal myself.
Like, now, let me ask you something. I don't mean to be sound like I'm interrupting you, but I think we have a little bit of a delay problem or something here, so you're not quite hearing me talk, but that's okay. We'll work through it. How did your brother take his life?
I had taken him to a mental health department in Los Angeles for treatment, and I had let them know that he had tried to kill himself before with medication, and they basically gave him enough Elavil to commit suicide, and that's what he did a week later.
And then how about your father?
My father shot himself, and I got called to go over to the house by my mother because she saw that my father was laying on the floor of the garage, and when I got there, the police and everybody was there, and they were trying to close the garage door, and I saw, what had happened, and
did you, do you have any other siblings?
I have a sister. She's younger than I am, and so she went through this trauma herself.
How is she doing?
She's doing well. She never got to the place of serious mental illness that I did. She's always been able to have a career and live her life and fully function.
I just want to tell you, I am amazed that you were able to go through two suicides and then your own struggle with mental stability and instability, okay, and come out of that and get degrees and go on to be a therapist. I mean, no, I am so absolutely, totally proud of you. My heart just goes out.
Thank you.
You know, you should write a book. You should, maybe you have. I don't know. Maybe you are. Because
I'm blogging my book. I actually have a blog. I think you mentioned something earlier about light at the end of the tunnel, and my blog is called Light at the End. And,
that's
I
nice.
Actually am writing it under a pseudonym, but it's, my memoir, and I'm hoping that someday I'll be able to get it published.
No, you will get it published. You got to think as I might, but I will win, not if. Think from
okay,
it. Think
it.
From it, not of it. I mean, if I can do it, you can do it. And you and I need to be a pillar of strength and a good example of life after death for for people who have experienced suicide, because really, the people that are really struggling are the survivors, you know? And is your mom still alive?
No, she passed away of cancer in 1986.
How did she deal with her son's suicide, then her husband's suicide?
Well, my mom was agoraphobic as well, and I didn't know that's what was going on when I was young, but I just know that she quit driving. She never went anywhere. She didn't socialize. And after my brother's suicide, she isolated herself even more. And she was also an alcoholic, so that's how she dealt with it.
She self-medicated.
And after my father passed away, she quit drinking and got a job for the first time since I was born.
Wow.
And really pulled herself up, too. So I feel proud of what she was able to do.
See, and that's a beautiful thing to say, and that leads me to what my goal was in my book. I don't know if you heard, but I have a book coming out in March. It's called Truth Be Told, a memoir of success, suicide, and survival. And it's the story of my life, which has been really was totally a crazy life, and the very intimate story of my success and then the meeting my husband and the success that we built together, and then the story of his suicide. And I had a couple of reasons for writing that book. The first and foremost important reason was because I'm a quasi-celebrity, not really, you know, big, but I am out there. Of course, people who knew nothing about it started blogging about it and saying really horrible things that weren't true about David and making up reasons for why he did it that weren't true. And of course, that's one of the negative things about that beautiful internet is that you can say anything you want about anybody and hurt anybody you want, and you can't get rid of it.
Yeah.
And my poor kids, who were devastated about their father committing suicide, all of a sudden, now they're looking at things on blogs that are talking about that, and it was horrific. And so one of my goals in writing the book was to tell the real, is that the truth be told, that my husband's suicide is understood, and people understood why he did it, and in honor of him and the beautiful man he was. And that what led me to say all of this is you sitting there saying, you know, my mom got it together, and in the end, I was so proud of her. And I think it's our job as family members of those who take their lives to keep the memory of the beautiful people they were alive. In other words, their light, you know, because and it's not easy. I know, you know, because there's so much negative. There's so much guilt, blame, anger, shame that surrounds suicide that the first couple years, it's all you can do to survive. Anyway, we're going to take a break. If you want to stay with us, we'll come back after the break for a few minutes. Is that all right?
Sure.
Okay, talk
in
a few minutes. All right, thanks. You're with Lucinda Bassett, and this is Truth Be Told. And don't panic. Come back with me in the next couple of minutes.
You think you got the best of me. Think you've had the last laugh. Bet you think that everything good is gone. Think you left me broken down. Think that I'll come running back. Baby, you don't know me cause you're dead wrong. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes you fighter. Put that fever light. Doesn't kill you, makes you stronger. Stand a little taller. Doesn't mean I'm lonely when I'm alone. What doesn't kill you makes you fighter. Put that fever lighter. Doesn't mean I'm over, cause you're gone. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger, stronger.
I love this song. Anyway, are you still with us, Linda?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Well, we've got a few minutes here, and I guess what excites me about you and talking to someone like you is that you've really been through, you know, hell, okay? And yeah. You are now 61 years old and sounds like you're an incredibly beautiful person. And you,
oh, thank you, you.
Well, you're such an inspiration. And do you have a good support system in your life now? Are you married? Do you have children? Do you have good girlfriends? I don't know, but do you have a good support system?
I do. I married a wonderful man 18 years ago, and he treats me like I'm the most important thing in the world. And I have 3 wonderful grown kids, 10 grandchildren, a great grandson already.
Woo! Wow. Yay.
And so, yeah,
I'm
very
jealous.
Loving family. And that really is my life. And when I am treating people who other people may think are beyond hope, I have hope because I've been there and
yes.
I'm on the other side. And so.
Yeah.
And that's just my passion now.
Well, your light is truly shining, and I am honored to have talked with you today. And I really appreciate the time you spent with us. James, are you trying to jump in there?
No, I'm just going to say, Linda, your story is so amazing. Obviously, you know Nicole from our team. If it's okay with you, Lucinda, I think she should be a guest blogger on your blog.
Please, yes. I think that's a great idea.
Oh, I would love to. I love to blog, and I love to write. So okay. that would be amazing.
Join our team, Linda. Join our little sparkle
thank
over
you.
Here. Okay. Oh, well, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you for sharing your story with me. And thank you for sharing your light with everybody, because that's clearly what you're doing. And you know, the other thing I want to say is what you're doing by living well is the best way to honor those that chose to leave. And that's what I learned. And that, you know, in my journey, that David took his life and that was his journey. And for some reason, I was on that journey with him. And so are my children. And, you know, and what we need to do is, in honor of him, is live well. And that is the challenge we're left with, us, you know, people who survive suicide, but of a loved one. But it is what we must do for ourselves and in honor of them and for our family members. And you're certainly doing that. So thank you very much. And hopefully we'll be seeing you on our blog.
Well, thank you for having me on your first show, Lucinda.
Thanks.
It was a pleasure.
Okay, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, for those of you who are calling in, we are getting some great calls. Just be patient. Right now, this is the first show, and when you call in, you might just get silence. Just hang in there. We're going to get you today. We're going to try to get to you today if we can, and just hang in there. Be patient. Don't panic, as I said. And I think we've got Ben on the line right now. We don't have Ben on the line right now.
Now would be a good time perhaps to talk to them about how they can get in touch with us via social media.
Okay, so what should we give them?
So you guys can interact with Lucinda directly at facebook.com/Lucinda Bassett, truth be told. That's all one word, Lucinda Bassett, B-A-S-S-E-T-T. So check up there. We're putting out content daily from Lucinda directly. We're having conversations, answering questions. So you guys can't get in today, make sure to check us out on Facebook as well. Twitter, we're on there all day, every day. And Twitter is at LB Truth Be Told. So just like Lucinda Bassett, Truth Be Told, Twitter is at LB Truth Be Told. We're tweeting right now live on the show, and you guys can follow us there on our social media networks.
Yes, it's all very exciting, and we have a caller we're going to take right now. Ben, are you with us?
Hello?
Hi, this is Lucinda. Hi, Ben, how are you?
I'm good, Lucinda. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your little light with us. I would love to hear your story. What's going on with you?
I don't have the most interesting of stories.
Hey, stop that. Everybody's story is interesting. Come on.
But for me, mine's very interesting. I grew up in the East Coast. You know, I was born in New York, moved to Connecticut, then moved later on to Boston. I'm so bored by it. I've been going to so much therapy, I forget what it's even about.
Talk to me. What do you mean you're bored by it? Is that what you said?
I'm very bored. I guess I'm very bored by it. I'm very, I'm kind of, when I look at my family, I'm not very proud of them.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, I don't, but in a way that kind of seems that they're all very self-interested.
Okay, how old are you?
I'm 23.
Okay, all right. And give me a little bit of history. Are you in school, or did you go to college, or are you working?
No, I went to school, and I went to college on the East Coast for about 3 years, and then I took a leave of absence, which turned into some travel. That turned into me trying to go back to school. That turned into me getting kicked out of school, and that turned into me going to rehab. Then that turned into me coming to California.
Oh, so are you out in L.A. now? Where are you?
Oh, I'm in Hollywood now, yeah.
You're in Hollywood. So here's what I'm hearing. You're having family problems in some ways. You're not feeling too close or connected. You went off to school, didn't work out. You probably did some drugs or drank, ended up in rehab, skipped around a little bit, tried to find yourself, ended up in rehab. Now you're hanging out here. You're 23 years old. You're frustrated. You don't really know what you want. You're a little depressed, a little pissed off at your family because they're not quite there for you, and you're a little lost.
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of those emotions I've already kind of been through, you know, in this whole, I don't know, it's almost been like enlightened for me, but really close.
Okay, and so, first of all, what are you doing about all that?
Right now I'm doing the only thing that I can do, which is basically surviving, you know, trying to, I try not to let things get to me. I try not to feel bad for things I do. If I know that I did something wrong, I try to just apologize for it. And not, I don't know, for some reason growing up, I was taught to look visibly hurt for an apology to be real. And I don't know, I'm tired of that. Now, if I make an action, I'm just going to accept that I did it and not feel any shame about it.
Well, how about we start off by, are you a religious person?
No, I mean, I'm open to all sorts of beliefs,
okay.
But I've never really...
I want you to Google agape. It's A-G-A-P-E when you hang up with me, which you're not going to do yet. But...
Oh, no.
Okay. I write that down, A-G-A-P-E. Michael Beckwith is the minister there, and it is the most amazing place. And it's a new kind of thinking about God that works for me, and it starts off with this. You are already good with God. Okay, you are already perfect just the way you are. I didn't put that applause in there, but anyway, my point of that is I'm not trying to be, you know, a spiritual guru up here, but I want to tell you that one of my personal goals when I was going through all this trauma and drama, my husband committed suicide 4 years ago. I don't know if you heard that. And then my brother went into a coma and died, and then my mother died, and I had to sell my business, and I was devastated. And I was funny. A friend of mine said, well, what do you want? A therapist friend of mine. And I said, well, I can't control this and I can't control that and I can't control this, but I can be good with God. I just want to be good with God before I die. And my friend's the spiritual person, and he laughed and he said, you're already good with God right now. You can let that one go. And it was so profound for me because I thought, no, I'm not. I'm not good enough for God because my husband committed suicide. I was molested when I was a kid. I was poor. I hitchhiked to Florida. I mean, you know, whatever it is you did, right? And I'm sharing this with you, Ben, because what I hear in you, and I don't even know you. I've only talked to you. You just gave me a minute of your story. Is I hear guilt, blame, anger, shame, okay? Which, by the way, was my mantra through my whole life. Guilt, blame, and I don't even know what you did. But whatever it was, it really doesn't matter right now. What matters is that Ben finds Ben and learns to just love Ben. I mean, you know, this whole, you don't need to go around and look hurt. You don't need to go around and apologize to people. Maybe you need to apologize to Ben. Because what you really need to do is really get to a place where you allow yourself to love yourself. And I know that all sounds really corny and hokey, but it is the truth. And it was, I'm telling you, I finally figured that out this year. For the friend, I'm a lot older than you. Someone took me to Agape and I sat there and I'm like, oh my God, these people all look so happy. And they are, and it's real. And some of them are dirt poor. Some of them have, you know, been in prison. Some of them were drug dealers. It doesn't matter, okay? I don't care what you did. What I care about is where you're at right now and how you feel about yourself, because that's where everything else is going to flow from. And so you really need, at 23, first of all, obviously you're intelligent, you're well-spoken, you're living in Hollywood, so you must be going after some kind of dream. At least you do have family. They're not all dead. There's, you know, I mean, you know, you don't have cancer. And I know you've been through a lot. I can tell it just by how you're talking. And I wish we had more time to get into it, but my show's going to end in 3 minutes. But if I want to make sure we get your address before you hang up so I can send you my book, because will you read it if I send it to you? Sorry about those applauses. You guys stop that for a minute. Will you read it if I send it to you?
Oh, no, 100%.
Okay. You said 100%. I want you to please Google Agape, and maybe I'll see you there. But in the meantime, I really appreciate you calling in, and I want to leave you with this thought that you, and I don't know if you heard me earlier, but you have something inside of you that makes you shine. And somewhere when you were growing up, you knew what it was. And somewhere along the way, someone put that light out. And now you got to find it again, because you're only 23, and I'm sure you're talented, and I'm sure you have big dreams, and boy, you better at 23. I have them, and I'm 56. You know, I'm only 26, really, but, you know, that's one of my dreams, is that I'll age backwards. I don't think that one's going to happen. Anyway, I feel your pain, but I also feel your soul, and I feel your potential. So I hope you do. And so whatever you've been through, it ain't that bad. The most important thing is knowing that when you hang up today, that you're an incredibly beautiful person right now with all of your baggage, because we all have it, and you need to let go of all this guilt, blame, anger, shame, and find yourself again. And you know what? You're in a beautiful place to do it. Los Angeles is lovely. So
yeah.
It is. And awesome. I have to go, because I have to say goodbye here. The show's going to end in a minute. But thank you so much for calling in. God bless you. I'll send you a book. And Google Agape, okay?
Thank you so much. This has really been my pleasure. Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you. Have a great day. Go make it a great day, okay? Go live your life beautifully. Thanks. All right. Well, that was a wonderful call. And this hour has flown by, as James said it would. My name's Lucinda Bassett, and I am here for you, and this is Truth Be Told, and I hope you join us next time. It's such an honor and a pleasure to share my thoughts with you. We're going to be joined by some incredible people sharing their stories and some incredible experts sharing their advice, and I hope you'll call in and share your light with us. So join us again for the next show. In the meantime, be sure to look for me at
LB Truth Be Told on Twitter and facebook.com/Lucinda Bassett Truth Be Told.
That's all new for me. So, you know, I got this gorgeous man over there just going to blurt it out like that. Thanks for joining me, and we'll see you next time here on Truth Be Told.
Remember all the things we wanted. Now all our memories, they're haunted. We were always meant to say goodbye.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more.